it's just something that we never really had to deal with in all of our 22 years of hosting people's websites. And again, I've been there since 1999, so I thought I'd seen everything that there was to possibly see on the internet. And in fact, there was a lot of stuff I wish I could unsee. I'm sure everyone in this room has had that experience. But this was a real PR crisis for us. It's an event that really got us asking the question, you know, what happens when your brand's own values are at odds with the demands of your own government? So you might not think of it as a PR crisis, because at the time, the coverage that we received and public opinion was definitely on our side throughout the entire ordeal. But for us, this actually was a bit of a crisis. We've never had to deal with anything like this before. And it might seem like we handled things well, but behind the scenes, it was completely nerve-wracking. But we weathered the storm, we kind of got through it. So I think the easiest way to walk you through it is just present a timeline of the events. It's pretty straightforward. We did see this coming, but we misjudged the level of public interest that this would generate. For us, it was a two-part crisis. The first part happened sort of internally, before any of this made its way into the public spotlight. It was sort of a crisis of conscience for us. We had to ask ourselves, you know, how do we stay true to our values and continue to operate legally, which is important. It wasn't yet a public crisis. That came later when we chose to go public. So the issue, this is a customer of ours, was a customer of ours, Disrupt J20. This was a site that was created to sort of help people organize protests on Donald Trump's inauguration. On that day, some protesters who may or may not have actually used, visited, or even heard of the site, ended up doing some property damage all over Washington, D.C. Private property, public property, all that stuff. So we didn't realize we hosted the site until we received this, a records preservation request from the Department of Justice. This is a pretty common request that we get. You know, again, we host 1.2 million domain names. There's no possible way for us to know the contents of every single one. But we typically find out about, you know, people doing shady stuff from the government or law enforcement or whatever, and that's fine. We work with them on a regular basis, as every web host does. But in effect, this was asking us to retain logs about the website, other forms of data about this user and their account. Just make sure they don't get wiped out by, you know, any automated systems that might rotate through logs or whatever. They just wanted us to hang on to it because they were going to come and ask us for it officially in the future. And again, that's super normal. For any web host that operates in the U.S. So eventually we did receive a subpoena, standard procedure. That's the next step in the process. The paperwork and the process has all been handled on the government side of things, and now they're approaching us to hand over that data. So in May of 2017, we were finally served with the subpoena for those records. There was one major difference with this subpoena from literally everyone we've ever received. And that typically, they're really just going after information about the website owner. Who put it up, you know, any information we have about content of the website itself. In this case, the government, Department of Justice, was specifically asking for complete access logs to the website. Any IP address that might have simply opened the site in a web browser, they wanted to hear about it. They wanted to know about it. All in all, that would have potentially put 1.3 million people in the government's crosshairs as part of this investigation. And again, the government doesn't tell us anything about the actual investigation into this website, this Disrupt J20 website. All we know is that they want this data from us, and that's where it ends. But they wanted IPs of everyone who's ever opened the websites, ever opened the website, timestamps, everything we had. And again, that was very different than the typical request that we get. So we had some questions, some comments, some concerns. This felt like an overly broad request, so we pushed back. We worked on it 4 months with them, back and forth, back and forth. We felt like we weren't getting anywhere. We'd propose our, you know, we'd let them know what our problems were with it, and they would ignore those questions and instead answer other questions in our emails. You know, simple procedural things, but never really getting at the main issue. So we kind of scratched our heads, and we didn't hand anything over, but we were thinking about it, and the government kind of sensed that we weren't going to play ball necessarily, so they served us with a warrant. Google image search a lot, and I'm not good at it. But they saw we were putting up a little bit of resistance, and we weren't going to roll over. So they reached for the next tool available to them, which is a warrant. So a subpoena effectively orders us to hand over evidence to investigators. A warrant authorizes the Department of Justice to just come to our house and search. absolutely nothing changed at all. They're looking for the exact same information, all 1.3 million IP addresses. And again, we asked them for clarification. You know, we're not comfortable handing this over. All 1.3 million people aren't part of your investigation. They can't possibly be. Let's just focus on the customer that we know about. But again, they go silent. Didn't answer, didn't address it. So then they reached for the next arrow in their quiver, a motion to compel. So this is very exciting. I'm not a lawyer, and I learned all of this as it happened, and it was amazing. But the motion to compel is basically a way for the government to, the investigators, to use the court system to force us to hand over information. So it's not just us and the DOJ anymore. Now it's a court, a judge has to get involved. So at this point, we're like, fine, that's awesome. Bring it on. Maybe a judge will listen to us and hear us out and give us answers and rule on this. So we thought about it. We thought about maybe, should we go public on this? Should we keep this, you know, in-house? Do people need to know about this? We weighed the pros and cons. There's a pro, there's a con. And we did ultimately decide to go public. Up until now, things have been pretty quiet. We're standing on the edge of something. We're standing right here, right between July 28th and August 14th. And we did go public in a blog post on our website. Of course, it's a WordPress blog. We love open software and big WordPress supporters. And we really did this to help our users understand what was going on. You know, we're fighting for you guys. Like, this is to protect your information. It might not be your website today, but tomorrow, this could be concerning. So we put that up, not really expecting to get much out of it. But what happened was, like, within 24 hours, crazy coverage everywhere. I think I got into work on a Tuesday, and I had literally 200 emails from international press all over the world asking for comment. Why did you do this? Asking for, you know, details about the warrant. So we had to take sort of a PR crash course lesson very, very quickly. you can see we were covered by the Washington Post, New York Times, The Hill, also TechCrunch, LA Times, Ars Technica, very small publications that no one's ever heard of. And it's very weird to get an email from, like, Anderson Cooper's producer asking if we could be on the air, you know, in 6 hours. So super weird. We did eventually make it onto cable news. On the left there, that's Dallas. He's one of our co-founders. On the right, that's Chris. He's our general counsel. And again, this all happened within the space of 24, 48 hours. But on the top there, you can see that's our WordPress blog. That was quoted word for word directly. It was great having our blog act as this one sort of source of truth. If you're a reporter and you don't have time to wait for an email from us answering your questions, you can just hit our blog, and that is our public statement. That has everything in there. And you know, this, you can't misinterpret our words, I would hope. We were very carefully putting those messages together. We chose our words super carefully. But that's a direct quote on cable news of something that I wrote. So as a result of all of this public attention, the original judge who granted that warrant was taken off the case. He's out. This was now set to go in front of Chief Judge Robert Morin. He was the head of the Washington, D.C. Superior Court. There is no one higher up in the Washington, D.C. Superior Court than the Chief Judge. And this hearing was a chance for us to finally get our concerns heard, instead of having them be ignored over email by the Department of Justice. So after the hearing, the Department of Justice backed down a little bit. I'm sorry, just before the hearing, they backed down a little bit, admitting at least one problem with their original request. We actually found out about this from Zoe Tillman, who's a reporter. They removed from their original request the request for any unpublished media, so draft blog posts, any content that existed on the server that might never have been made public. Now they're saying they didn't want it. But also any HTTP error logs, access logs. They basically said, yeah, we never wanted that information. We don't know what you guys are talking about. Like, that's crazy. Why would you ask for that? But, you know, they were asking for it up until this point. I think the public attention finally got to them. So we saw this as a win, but it didn't go far enough for us. We still had some concerns. There were some lingering issues with the warrant itself, and we did still have this upcoming hearing. But again, we went to our blog to spell out what this meant. Excruciating detail. You end up repeating yourself about a million times when you go through something like this. Once on your blog, you know, 20 times on the phone to reporters, and a couple more over email. you get very familiar with the nuances of the case very quickly when you do that. So we were excited about this revision of the government's request, but we weren't done fighting, and we did have that court date for our hearing coming up. So of course, it led to more of this, more coverage. But at this point, that sort of initial wave of breathless public interest had kind of waned a little bit. And that's okay, because we were starting to see these longer form pieces and content pieces and in-depth analysis and opinion that we really appreciated. We saw some thoughtful arguments on both sides of it. So this is the Washington, D.C. Superior Courthouse. Public hearing happened. Reporters had actually flown in from all over the world. I was there and saw, I think I counted about 50 or 60. Amazing. The courtroom filled up so quickly that they had to take two unused courtrooms adjacent to it and piped in the audio so that all of the press could hear what was going on. So we did immediately after it an impromptu press conference on the steps of the courthouse. Again, we've never done anything like this before. But the judge heard our arguments and he actually listened to us and he did tend to agree with our concerns. It sounded like the DOJ wasn't going to get what they were asking for. They weren't going to get what they wanted. But we did still need to wait for the court's official ruling. You know, what the judge happens to say and the questions he asks, those aren't necessarily rulings. But remember, this is just a hearing, so he heard us, and we definitely felt heard. The ruling would come later. So we went back to the blog to sort of tout our victory and say, things are sounding great at this point, things are looking great at this point, but ultimately, we needed to wait. And they say the wheels of justice turn slowly. That's very true. In this case, it took about a month and a half, close to 2 months, for the judge to review the case and issue a ruling. And his ruling was fantastic. It was a huge win for us. Basically got everything that we had asked for. He agreed that there were serious First and Fourth Amendment concerns with the government's request. So we did have to hand over information, but we had to redact all identifying information to protect the identities of anyone who used the website, if those identities were mailed to us, anyone who wasn't our direct customer. The court had to act as the go-between between us, DreamHost, and the Department of Justice. Couldn't just hand this data straight to the DOJ as we typically would. We now had to hand it to the court. They would review it. They would make sure that nothing in that documentation would run afoul of that identification ruling, and then they would hand it to the DOJ. And then finally, the DOJ had to provide the court with a list of names of everyone on their end who would have access to that data. So this, of course, led to another round of media coverage. and it just was crazy, and of course, we went back to our blog. To sort of explain that we've finally done it, we're at the end of the road. The end result is that we had to hand over a drastically reduced amount of data to the government. And we had to redact anything that could be used to personally identify anyone from every scrap of it. And that made us feel much more comfortable. That put this request in line with every other data request that we've gotten from the government in the past. We just wish it hadn't taken 10 months to get here. It undoubtedly cost a ton of taxpayer money on the DOJ side fighting it, and it cost us a considerable amount as well on our legal fee. We had to spend a fair amount of cash on our lawyers. So speaking of money, a lot of people took this case very, very personally. We were hearing on a daily basis from not just our own customers, but from non-customers as well, people that didn't even have websites. They were just reading about this in the mass media. But they took it personally. They felt a connection to this case, very inspired. And they kept offering to help us, and they didn't know how, and we didn't really know what they could do for us anyway. I mean, we could afford to pay our own legal bills. But in the end, we decided to set up a crowdfunding site using this website called crowdjustice.com. It helps people sort of pay their legal bills in a crowdfunded type way. The goal here wasn't to make money on this. The goal is to help people not feel helpless. We wanted them to feel like they were part of something larger, and they absolutely told us that they did. We didn't hit our crowdfunding goal on this, but that's okay, it doesn't matter. I think just doing this was important. So during the time that we've been in the spotlight, we've been in constant contact with media and press, but true to our spirit of transparency, we also needed a way to share those longer form updates with the general public throughout the whole process. So you can see, we can expand these milestones and see where our public statements fit in to each of those events. So we thought, what better place for it than our WordPress blog? So that's exactly what we did. every step of the way, we maintained our log as the constant source of truth because we had 100% control over it, 100% control over the platform. This wasn't some press person offering their interpretation of events. This wasn't a social media network sort of highlighting or elevating certain types of content and maybe not telling the story that we would want to tell. We are very much committed to the open web. So there were four key milestones in this case. Each one gave us a little bit of a traffic boost. Of course, it's not sustainable, and that's not why we did it. I just thought this was interesting to look at. But they represent the levels of public interest here. So one of the takeaways for us is that, you know, when the media comes calling, you need to answer them immediately. Don't wait for them to go away, because that's actually bad. Don't freeze up. You need to act. And this quote here is the implication. You know, they're reaching out to you. I'm writing a story about you. You know, you can talk to me so I can get the details right, or you can ignore me and I'll work with what I have. I'll read about what people are saying about you on the internet. I'll do my own research, and I'll draw my own conclusions. That's not ideal, especially in a case like this where there's a real opportunity for your brand to be put in a positive light. So take advantage of this opportunity when it comes. Some people, it may never come. Establish talking points. That was a huge time saver for us. You know, take advantage of that opportunity to give a quote, but be prepared. Talking points are just a handful of bullet points that you can elaborate on. That's all. That's all you need. It's for 90% of the requests you get, it'll fulfill those. But confirm that they're still valid every time, because the situation will change over time. And in a case like ours, the situation was often changing day to day, so we had to make sure we were still telling people the right stuff and engage quickly. The more outlets that receive the same messaging from you, the stronger your points become. And that signal boost that they give you is consistent and effective. So why did this work? How is this possible? Why did the world sort of rise up and take notice and decide all of a sudden that privacy on the internet was important? It shouldn't have, right? Because we're so fragmented and political discourse has become so divisive and all that stuff. So you've got people on the left and on the right and just like whatever from all over the world. So sometimes it feels like the only thing that people can agree on is that murder is bad. Sometimes you're not even sure about that anymore. But it worked because of this. Privacy is a universal concern. It affects everyone equally. It doesn't favor certain worldviews or ideologies. When you're working on a communications team, or you're determining a communications strategy for like your company or a brand or a client, that's a good thing to keep in mind, particularly if you're working with an online brand where people are very, very sensitive to issues of privacy. Don't let the size of your response team slow you down. In our case, it was one person. That was me. So I had to deal with a lot of these different agencies reaching out. But what we did was we kind of lifted at which outlets have the widest reach. We sort of worked our way down. NPR is a national brand. Everyone knows them, right? LA Times, kind of regional. So NPR gets the first response. You know, there's only so many hours in the day. Wall Street Journal is an internationally recognized brand. Ars Technica probably has a smaller readership. Politico, with 3.63 million followers, probably deserves a faster response than the_tech_news. 58 followers. So everyone deserves a response, and everyone should eventually get one. But when you've got a small team, you need to prioritize the ones that will boost your signal fastest. So takeaways: a crisis can take many forms, even a positive crisis, because you need to effectively manage it. Stay true to your values. Luckily, we had values. We were able to rely on those, lean on those, and figure out what our next move for me. Your own story. Use a blog. Use an open platform on the web to tell your story whenever you can. Don't ignore media requests. They can be your biggest ally in times like this. Even if you're going through a negative PR crisis, get an opportunity to tell your side. Establish and curate talking points. Huge for us. Absolutely helps you stay on message, especially if you have more than one person in your organization speaking to media or external sources. This gets everybody on the same page. And curate them so they're up to date. Prioritize replies based on reach. Raise open platforms. WordPress is an ideal platform for long-form content. I know it's hip to use it as a CMS, but I still love it as a blog platform. It's my favorite thing. And be authentic. Don't invent some kind of brand voice that doesn't actually exist in your organization just because you think it's going to get you a better public response. So that's pretty much it for me. Thanks, guys. I am tremendous value on Twitter, aka Gas Station Sushi, which is a real thing in California where I'm from. It's only marginally better than Costco sushi, but it is a real thing. Thanks. Good questions, yeah?
Two questions. First of all, did you engage with a public relations firm for the people in your team who had to go on TV and talk to those people to get coaching on how to deal with all that kind of stuff?
Yeah, so we do work with a PR firm, but they're more of an idea to bounce ideas off of. We ultimately decide on the messaging strategy and all that. We did send our people that were going to be on cable news to a quick 30-minute phone call with them. If there's some pitfalls you're looking for, stick to your talking points. It's just very basic stuff. But yeah, that helped quite a bit. There were many cases of reporters trying to talk us into a corner where they were like, well, now don't you think this particular investigation was initiated by the Trump administration because of XYZ? And for us, we had to steer clear of that because we didn't know anything about the investigation, and honestly, we didn't care. We were really just cared about the privacy of our customers.
Okay, and the other question is did anything ever happen to the person who put up that site?
Yeah, the investigation went on for quite a bit, and ultimately all charges were dropped, I think, last year at some point.
But what did they charge them with? Like inciting craziness?
Or inciting violence. I don't remember exactly. Okay. But yeah.
Thank you.
Yep. Yes.
So you mentioned you had that crowd justice sort of crowdfunding, and that obviously y'all were able to afford your own lawyers and stuff, so this wasn't, a fund. What did that money eventually go towards in the end, not just avoid of contribute to feel better than it disappears?
Well, because we didn't hit our crowdfunding goal, all the money went back to the donors.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, if we hadn't hit the goal, we would have, allocated it towards our legal bills. Cool. Thank you. Yes?
How long did it take? What was the process of actually doing all that back delivering the product?
I think it took us about 3 to 4 months. We have legal counsel internally. We don't work with an agency or anything. I think they pulled in 3 or 4 of their team to just work on that and almost nothing else for a solid 3 to 4 months. So it took a fair amount of time even after this victory.
So it all had to turn into prints and then go
forward? I think we transferred it digitally. I'm not sure what they used to redact it, but I'm sure it wasn't one of those things where they just changed the background to black. They're pretty small. But it took a long time. Yes?
I was wondering, you know, what exactly was left?
It was basic information about our customer. It was a complete archive of the public contents of their website. It would have included probably their contact information, name, address, phone number, and their IP addresses only.
What actually ended up getting
Just that, exactly right. It's a very, very limited subset of their original request. Yes?
I just want to say thank you very much.
Sure.
Yeah, really. Thank you.
Thanks. I get that a lot. I saw you first. There.
I was curious, how was it being done by a consultant?
No, our in-house legal counsel went through all of that and redacted it with a small team of 3 or 4 people. Completely in-house. We then passed it to the court to go through to make sure we actually did that redaction. That was the court's request, and then the court then passed it on to the DOJ once they were sufficiently, once they understood that it was sanitized to their satisfaction.
Did you think it was
No, I'm pretty sure we would have done it digitally. Yeah. Yes?
Did this incident change your relationship with the DOJ?
It's interesting. our corporate counsel tells us that anytime he heads into court, there's like this professional camaraderie between lawyers, no matter what side of the case they're on. They'll say, hey, how you doing? Shake hands. When we walked into that courtroom for the hearing, the DOJ wouldn't even make eye contact with us. They were very much, stone-faced, I guess you could say. So since then, I think they've put different people on our account or whatever. I think we've dealt with those investigators since. Yes?
Why wasn't Bill Warren the end of the story? Was the DOJ was not able to get access to the systems to make the information available?
Yeah, there were some procedural issues that we had with it. And also, these people were, on inauguration day, were exercising their right to publicly assemble, which, you know, is something that could be put into question, I guess, if the government starts investigating, pursuing these types of investigations beyond just a website owner, if they're now starting to use a website as an investigative tool to sort of sweep up any possible person who could have had any possible connection. It's very different than doing a targeted search for one specific user or small group of users.
But were they able to exercise the warrant and actually get into your system?
No, no. That's why they pushed for that motion to compel. We were not compliant. Yes, in the back.
You said sort of establishing DreamHost's bona fides in terms of your overall philosophy, you know, your ethics and so on. How does that actually play practically into when these sort of requests roll in? Do you have in-house guidance to say, all right, this meets our moral, ethical, legal guidelines for this sort of request, or is it more messable?
For us, it's really, we want to be able to operate legally in the United States, and we'll do whatever it takes to accomplish that. So, everyone is a bit of a judgment call, but we do go over every single subpoena, every single warrant with a very fine-tooth comb. If we find something that's even a little bit, you know, incorrect, like filed in the wrong jurisdiction or something, we'll reject it. And we reject, I want to say, something like 30% to 40% of the ones that we get for simple procedural mistakes alone. So we don't just roll over on every single one. And when issues like this come up, we do definitely take it to our value squad to kind of run it by them and say, what do you think about this? This is something that we're dealing with. So yeah, it does play quite a big part. Thank you for that. Yes?
Just really quick, is the value squad like a paid position? Like, is that?
No, it's
like a volunteer.
It's a volunteer thing. It's all employees. Maybe once a month to kind of go over, you know, new marketing initiatives. I know when we started doing some email marketing, there was some tension in the company because all email marketing is spam. So that had to go in front of the value squad, and we had to kind of soothe people a bit. But yeah, cool. It's a fun place to be. Yes.
So how often does this happen to you when you get requests for stuff?
We get, gosh, I wish I could tell you. We get quite a few, but again, let's say 3 to 4 a month. And all types of different content, breaking all kinds of different laws.
Okay.
But again, that's very common throughout the whole web hosting industry.
Yeah.
But it's not a part of the industry that you typically hear about. Yes?
If this were to happen again, would you guys negotiate to get to the same arrangement, or would you fight it all the way from the beginning?
Yeah, I mean, I think we would fight it again to get to the same arrangement. Here, you know, luckily we have this in our back pocket as a bit of a precedent as to how things could go. Hopefully, what we did here helps the entire hosting industry out as well, because they don't necessarily have to roll over on every single request. Now, this is a good example of someone standing up and sort of open sourcing policy. Yes.
Do you get similar requests from international residents?
I don't know that we do. I think we get GDPR concerns more than anything else. But these types of requests typically have to be filed with the U.S. agency. You know, that's how that is. Sweet. No more questions. Appreciate your time. Thanks, everybody.